Heaven sent.
In a world of constant progression such as ours, it's no surprise that our entertainment mediums are constantly evolving. On this channel, we've covered the many advances of gaming technology that were found in the sixth generation of consoles, as well as the many different ambitious titles that were released on these platforms. From this era, we've come to experience some of the most influential games of all time, some of which truly shifted the direction in which games were meant to be played. From refining the third-person view perspective to making ADS a very prevalent mechanic in first-person shooters, many different techniques and concepts were tested in the massive amount of sixth-generation titles. With the gaming industry on such a steady climb to the top, it was only a matter of time until things were going to reach a peak. For those like me who grew up playing on a PS2, Xbox Original, or Nintendo GameCube, there came a time period in which the gaming industry felt limitless in its ability to leave its players in amazement and wonder. A year that paved the way for some of the greatest titles to ever grace our TV screens, and a year in which our fate as avid gamers would be forever sealed. A time in which AAA gaming was at its very best, and a moment in which some of the most successful IPs of all time released their best game. For what may have been the greatest year in gaming, I'm talking about the year of 2004. And as we embark on our journey throughout the many accomplishments and great titles that were released in this year, it's important to remember that the contents of this video are subjective, and only the opinion of myself and other like-minded individuals in my circle. We all have a different idea of what the greatest time in gaming was, but by the end of this video, I'm hoping you'll be able to understand where I'm coming from. So without further ado, let's transport ourselves back to the magical year of 2004 and begin our journey into what may have been the greatest time in gaming history.
Tournament just went into overdrive. Featuring a wealth of new maps, one-on-one combat, and large-scale battles in huge environments. Reload. Rev up. Ride out. Car Jet. Unreal Tournament 2004.
When looking back on the past of gaming and its many multiplayer concepts, the term arena shooter is sure to be familiar to many gamers of the late 90s and early 2000s. Arena shooters were first introduced through the 1993 release of Doom on the PC, and with the massive success of Doom and its steadily growing player base in serious need of more blood-soaked arena combat, id Software found it necessary to bring the likes of arena shooting into a new three-dimensional world with the 1996 release of Quake. Quake was one of the most critically acclaimed games of the late 90s, and was also a massive step forward into the world of online gaming. With having over 1.7 million copies sold by December of 1997, Quake and the concept of arena shooters had become a household name for gamers all across the globe. And with this new era of multiplayer gaming becoming more and more popular, it was only right for many other game developers to try and dip their feet into the genre. Luckily, the next big thing was right around the corner, with the debut of the Unreal series. Unreal was first released in May of 1998, and was actually the very first game to showcase the power of the Unreal Engine, which is still widely used in present-day development. But since we're here to talk about the best games of 2004, it only makes sense we direct our attention to the sixth entry in the Unreal series, that being Unreal Tournament 2004. Released in North America on March 16th, this title was an incredible feat in terms of multiplayer gaming, with a vast selection of maps and multiplayer modes, a wide variety of weapons, and extensive mod support for those looking to build and upload their own creations, Unreal Tournament 2004 was one of the most successful and widely loved arena shooters of all time, boasting an impressive 93 score on Metacritic and being regarded as the peak of Unreal Tournament games. It's definitely a title that holds a special place in the hearts of many that were there to experience the game in its heyday. I had personally missed out on this title as a kid, but as always, I like to play any game that I include in my videos so that I can gain some personal experience behind them. All the gameplay footage on display was recorded through my own personal playthroughs, and I gotta say, this game still holds up. It had been such a long time since I had loaded into the original experience of an arena shooter, but this game was an absolute blast to play. With up to 12 different game modes, 18 different weapons, and addictive fast-paced combat mechanics, you were sure to find yourself glued to your CRT monitor for many nights to come. Unfortunately, in present day, the official Unreal servers have been offline for some time now. But luckily, the community is still very much alive and took it upon themselves to host their own master server for those who are still interested in playing. With the early 2000s being at ground zero for the evolution of multiplayer gaming, it's only right that we include this game on the list. And for anyone interested in playing this game in present day, just know you'll have to do a bit of digging. But for a title that's almost 20 years old, it's well worth the trouble. So with that being said, I hope to see you in the arena, my friends, but don't expect me to take it easy on you. In the early 2000s, multiplayer gaming was just beginning to pick up some serious speed, and as we had previously mentioned before, one of the most prolific multiplayer IPs of this time were that of the Quake and Doom series. With the 1997 release of Doom 64 being the latest entry at that time, it was safe to say that Doom supporters all over the world were praying for their next fix of demon slaying debauchery. And luckily for this highly dedicated fanbase, these prayers would soon be answered. On August 3rd of 2004, Doom 3 was released on both the Xbox Original and Windows PC, boasting an 87 score on Metacritic, as well as winning multiple awards for PC Game of the Year. Doom 3 was a critical victory and was more than its fans could have ever hoped for. With the technological capabilities of the 6th generation consoles and computers being pushed to their limits with this game, the Doom universe was now brought to life with more detail than ever before. Taking place in a fully realized world with incredible sound design and atmospheric landscapes, brought the intensity to new heights, and really drove home the horror and disparity that's found throughout the Doom universe. Now, while the overall look and sound of this game had been improved upon all of its predecessors, its software still kept their fans in mind when sticking to the formula that made this series so beloved. The familiar run-and-gun aspect was still very much alive, and was even improved upon with more fluid movement and animations. The environments and level designs are extraordinarily detailed, leaving you with many clues, voice recordings, and characters to discover throughout the intensely paced story mode. And with a wide selection of enemy types capable of ambushing you at any moment's notice, Doom 3 really carried a sense of dread that kept you on your toes, which constantly heightened the immersion throughout the 11-hour campaign. That's not all this game had to offer. As we said before, Doom is a series that had built its fan base upon its multiplayer mode. And with the improvements in visuals as well as gameplay mechanics, this also made for a very solid multiplayer experience. Starting with 4-player capability and 4 variations of deathmatch, Doom 3 gave its player base plenty to work with in a new age of multiplayer gaming. There was also story mode co-op for those playing on the Xbox version, as well as later DLC being added to the multiplayer and story modes. With a 7-year deficit between Doom 64 and Doom 3, it was obvious that id Software had taken their time in crafting this game. Doom 3 was an exceptional title for its time, and still delivers an amazing action horror experience to this very day. In what may have been the greatest time for gaming, Doom 3 was an important stepping stone in making this year such a massive success, and for that, it'll be forever solidified in gaming history.
Money. Power. Respect. That's what our code is all about.
Forget the code.
If there was any music genre that truly reigned supreme in the year of 2004, I'd have to put my money on hip-hop being the overall favorite. And with it having such an impact on the rebellious youth of the early 2000s, it's a no-brainer that our media outlets were also heavily influenced by its culture. With hip-hop having such a chokehold on nearly every corner of the entertainment industry, it only made sense that we would see more of an urban influence in many games of the early 2000s. This yielded some varying results, with some games overstepping their reach. But when this formula was done right, it certainly made way for some memorable classics, and among some of the most legendary titles was Def Jam Fight for NY. Being the much improved sequel to Def Jam Vendetta, Fight for NY was a breath of fresh air for fans of the fighting genre. This game took the OG formula of most beat-em-up titles, mixed it with fully interactive environments, and basically created one of the most in-depth fighting games of its time. And it was much more than just button mashing and repetition. The wide roster of playable characters were also accompanied with multiple fighting styles, meaning there was plenty of variety and techniques to choose from and master. And unlike the previous titles of the Def Jam series, in Fight for NY, you're given the opportunity to create your own fighter through the fast-paced story mode campaign. In this mode, you'll find yourself punching and slamming your way through the ranks of an underground fighting organization. When opposing sides begin to clash, going to be up to you and your fighting skills to find out which team will reign supreme. It's a fun and challenging experience, and holds a great amount of replay value. With the option of creating multiple profiles for new fighters, you'll find yourself wanting to try out all the many different fighting styles, as well as new combinations of finishing moves, and maybe even new girlfriends to interact with. With the single player experience being so incredible in this game, it was only right that they also include a variety of multiplayer modes to play with your friends. With up to 9 different match types, there's plenty of options in terms of solo or couch co-op. I personally had some of my greatest childhood memories in the night spent playing free-for-all mode with my friends back in the day. And although I may be a bit biased in saying this is one of the greatest games of all time, I can confidently say that this really is one of the greatest games of the year 2004. With over 60 plus playable characters, an engaging story mode with plenty of customization, and an amazing soundtrack to boot, Fight for NY is sure to have a spot in the heart of any fighting game fan, even in present day. While the Def Jam series has gone cold ever since the Rocky release of Icon, many people are still playing Fight for NY, and even has a place in certain esports circuits. If you've yet to give this game a shot, now is the time to do so. But just remember to keep your guard up, because there ain't no love in the heart of the city.
No love. No, you're ready to stop, don't we?
We are the lazy generation, no more standing out in line. So good at wasting our time.
When it comes to tires burning and nitrous tanks hissing in the cockpit of an import tuner, the early 2000s were a hotbed for influential street racing media. With the 2001 release of the very first Fast and Furious film, a new generation of adrenaline junkies were formed in its wake, and to further satiate these cravings of high speeds and slick drifts came a whole slew of incredible street racing IPs. A contagious case of Leadfoot was sweeping the nation, leaving little room for any other competitors looking to get their foot in the door. With the Midnight Club and Need for Speed franchise holding such a dominant position on the market of racing games, it seemed as if there were no other options in terms of fast-paced racing simulators. But with the debut of the Burnout series on November of 2001, a breath of fresh air was found in a new era of next-generation gaming. The Burnout series was found to be quite successful from the jump, but what we're really here to talk about is the game that many regard as the peak of Burnout titles, that being Burnout 3 Takedown. Burnout 3 was somewhat of a bastard child in terms of development, as it was being developed under a fractured relationship between Criterion Games and Electronic Arts. You see, at the time, Criterion Games was made up of a team of around 130 or so developers. These devs were then split into two teams for two separate projects, one project being Burnout 2 Point of Impact, set to be published by Acclaim Entertainment, and the other, Airblade for Sony Entertainment Europe. And while Airblade was a pretty sweet game at its time, Criterion had no further interest in continuing the series, and instead reached out to EA in order to see if they were interested in publishing a remake of the 1988 skateboarding game, Skate or Die. EA accepted, and with Criterion keen to work with their newfound publisher, many talks of a new Need for Speed game in the style of Burnout were abuzz between the two companies. The proposed title for the game was Need for Speed Split Second. It was drawn up to be a stunt-driven arcade-style racing game. But unfortunately, these dreams were soon diminished, Criterion and EA parting ways over indifferences in the development of Skate or Die. It felt like all these great ideas were going to be thrown out the window, and now there was no hope for the idea of a new unique spin on a racing game. But luckily, things shifted when Criterion's director of design was approached by the executive VP of EA Worldwide. EA wanted to work on a new game with them, and while Criterion was hesitant at first, EA eventually won them over with a suggestion. They suggested they work on a whole new Burnout game. Criterion finally agreed, but only on the terms that they could have full creative control of the project. EA agreed with these terms, and the development for Burnout 3 was in full swing. And for many fans of the Burnout games, a new staple in this series was soon to come. On September 7th of 2004, Burnout 3 Takedown was finally released on PlayStation 2 and Xbox Original. With an impressive score of 94 on Metacritic and multiple awards and nominations, Burnout 3 Takedown was an incredibly satisfying experience for not only racing fans, but the majority of gamers in general. Where most racing games would rely on safe driving and avoiding danger at all costs, Burnout 3 was the exact opposite. It would encourage its players to drive as reckless as possible. Whether it's speeding through oncoming traffic, knocking your opponents off the road, or taking an off-the-rail shortcut, your top speed will heavily depend on you maintaining a steady boost. And the only way to maintain that boost is by driving like a complete maniac. And as you can imagine, it's fun as hell. With up to 67 different vehicles, a career mode of over 170 events, and 5 different game modes, Burnout 3 gave its players plenty to work with, and a formula that made sure they were always coming back for more. Burnout 3 was also the first of the series to include a fully licensed soundtrack, boasting some of the greatest names in alternative and hard rock bands at that time, which perfectly encapsulated the chaos and energy that this game provides, and really works to immerse the player throughout the many adrenaline-soaked circuits to spend your time racing through. Burnout 3 was a pivotal point for Criterion Games, and was arguably their best game ever released. It's one of those titles that really should be experienced by everyone, and is sure to bring many hours of excitement to any night of gaming. While the latest game in the Burnout series was a remaster of Paradise in 2018, one can only hope they do the same for Takedown. But even if it never happens, it's safe to say that Burnout 3 still will stand the test of time, and is sure to bring excitement for many more years to come.
Theft Auto, San Andreas, out now. Rated M for mature.
The early 2000s were a breeding ground for some of the most influential titles in gaming history. When it comes to innovation in the gaming industry, it's hard to argue a more inventive video game franchise than the Grand Theft Auto series. With the first two GTA games being comprised of two-dimensional backgrounds and a top-down perspective, it was thought to be unlikely that the series would have ever made a significant impact without some changes being made. But with the introduction of GTA 3 on October of 2001, a new beast in gaming was officially born. Boasting a three-dimensional open world to explore, and the freedom to choose your own playstyle, GTA 3 was Pandora's box in terms of open world gaming. And while the third entry may not hold up well in today's standards, those who were there at the time of the game's release know exactly how big of a deal this game was. With success of this magnitude being found in the GTA IP, it was only right that Rockstar had put their heads together for another go at it. GTA Vice City was released just a little over a year later, and with the widespread success of both GTA 3 and Vice City, it was safe to say that this series had officially become a staple in the gaming community. While Vice City did improve upon many aspects of the third entry, there was still plenty of room for possibility left for Grand Theft Auto titles of the future, and if there was one thing for certain, it's that GTA had a very promising future. Unluckily for gamers in the wonderful year of 2004, we came to experience what many regard as the greatest GTA game of all time, Grand Theft Auto San Andreas. Released on October 26th of 2004, GTA San Andreas was a pivotal moment for not only Rockstar Games, but for the world of gaming as a whole. The amount of content that was packed into San Andreas was unbelievable for its time, and truly set the standard for how massive an open-world gaming experience could be on 6th-generation hardware. With the newly implemented stat system being added to the main protagonist, it aimed to give players a unique experience in their own playthroughs. Whether you're building muscle at the gym, refining your aim, or becoming the ultimate wheelman, this new RPG element of upgrading stats was a great way to immerse the player and give them a unique experience in each playthrough. And when we're talking about newly added features in a GTA game, the stat system was only the tip of the iceberg. While the previous GTA titles had a wide range of activities from taxi driving to vigilante missions, San Andreas had a hold my beer moment and just flooded the game with what seemed like an endless amount of possibility. From home invasions to derby racing, playing a game of basketball or hitting the casino, the options felt limitless, and adding such a plethora of mini-games to an already massive open world to explore gave players a dream experience in the state of 2004 gaming. I mean, even going back and playing this game in today's standards, it's pretty amazing to see what Rockstar was able to accomplish. And even with the release of two more recent games in the series, I still find that no other GTA can surpass San Andreas in terms of content and freedom. The storyline was solid and provided plenty of length with over 100 mainline missions. And with the script of San Andreas' story being handled by Dan Houser, an English-born writer for Rockstar, they were looking to get boots on the ground and really soak in the atmosphere of California and Nevada, the two locations in which the world of San Andreas is inspired by. With the game's story being inspired by the influence of early 90s West Coast gang culture, Rockstar had brought aboard DJ Pooh to co-write the narrative of San Andreas. The entire development team also took a massive road trip together, in which they all surveyed and photographed many different areas and landmarks of Los Angeles and Las Vegas. This extra amount of effort really showed in how well the game represented the vibe and feel of the West Coast in the early 90s, and was also carried by an incredible catalog of some of the 90s greatest musical hits. I mean, this game really had it all. And while magic was certainly in the air for gaming in the year 2004, it'd be nothing short of a tragedy for me to not mention this title on our list. And as I'm going to assume that any gamer who hasn't been living under a rock in the past 20 years has already experienced this masterpiece, I absolutely recommend you give it another playthrough sometime soon. And just see for yourself how timeless this classic really is. But just be sure to wear the right colors, because it's Grove Street or No Street. Now, moving on to the month of November in 2004, things were really beginning to heat up in the gaming industry. With so many incredible titles being released in the prior month of October, you would have thought that all energy had already been expelled into the world of gaming. But we've only met our halfway mark on this list of legendary games, and now it's time that we descend further into the depths of nostalgia to recount one of gaming's greatest offerings in the realm of racing titles. I'm talking about Need for Speed Underground 2. Released in North America on November 9, 2004, Underground 2 was a direct sequel to the first game in the series. With the storyline picking up after the initial events of the first game, you will find yourself drifting your way up the ranks of an underground street racing syndicate. And while the story mode had its perks in terms of characters and narrative, what really made this game shine was its incredibly fun driving mechanics, as well as immaculate customization offerings. With a wide range of American, Japanese, and European model vehicles, you'll find yourself with plenty of options to pick and choose from. Starting with the customization features in this game, you'll come to find that you can tweak virtually everything cosmetic. From neon lights to the sound system under the trunk, Underground 2 gave its players a wide variety of options to ensure each player could put their own unique spin on the vehicle of their liking, and also include a variety of performance upgrades to ensure you're able to keep up with the competition. This customization is really what drove players to sink insane amounts of hours into the game, as the possibilities really felt limitless. But not only was the customization a selling point for this title, as I previously mentioned before, this game had some really tight mechanics, and even had somewhat of a pretty steep learning curve when it came to certain driving styles. It opened up a possibility for players to really feel a sense of progression in each playthrough, and as you get better as a driver, so do your opponents. Underground 2 was also the first game in the series to feature an open world, where players can freely roam and explore the city. In order to progress and unlock new areas on the map, you'll have to participate and win throughout a variety of different racing modes. Each racing type has its own unique feel and its own range of mechanics to learn and master. And while some of these game modes may be a bit frustrating to learn at first, they really begin to grow on you as you work your way up the street racing hierarchy. The game also included a licensed soundtrack of 27 different songs, perfect for speeding your way through the busy streets of Bayview. All in all, Underground 2 was an incredible experience for many racing fans of the early 2000s, and is seen as one of the best titles in the lengthy catalog of Need for Speed games, with some incredible visuals for its time and perfecting the ambiance of street racing culture. It's one of those games that really was a must-play then and a must-play now. So grab your keys and shift some gears, because it's time to fly.
I won't.
When it comes to the talk of legendary gaming IPs in the early 2000s, it really is hard to find one that holds more weight than the Halo series. With the release of the original Xbox console November 15, 2001, Microsoft knew they were going to have to come correct if they were looking to compete in the cutthroat era of console wars. This meant that they were going to need an exclusive launch title, a game that players could not afford to miss. And as we all remember, that game was Halo Combat Evolved. And with it being given over 5 awards, a 97 score on Metacritic, and building timeless memories for the over 5 million people who purchased the game, it was an absolute no-brainer that Microsoft was hastily sweet-talking Bungie into releasing a sequel to this masterpiece. The hype was real, and with the announcement of Halo 2 at E3 2003, well, just have a look for yourself. Halo 2 sought to be the biggest game of 2004. When it comes to the number of units this game was pushing, it's hard to argue they didn't achieve just that. With over $125 million in sales on the first day of its release, it was safe to say that almost every couch on planet Earth had a Mountain Dew chugging Spartan enthusiast seated in amazement. Boasting an incredible campaign that continued the story of Master Chief and his army of Spartans, Halo 2 picks up where things left off, continuing a further dive into the missing plot points of the first game, and even gave its players a new perspective through the so-called bad guys of the Halo universe, the Covenant. And while the campaign was a huge deal for those who loved the lore and the characters of Halo, the main selling point of this game was found in the presence of its multiplayer modes. Halo 2 for some was the introduction to online gaming, as high-speed connections were becoming more readily available in the year 2004. With Xbox Live leading the charge in terms of online console gaming, Halo 2 arrived just in time to show everybody what first-person shooters were capable of in a competitive setting. With the introduction of a matchmaking system, players were able to join lobbies with ease and even meet new players. And while matchmaking isn't extremely common practice in today's gaming, this was new tech at its time, and giving players that ability to join matches so quickly really aided to the game's growth and steady player count. And with a game finding such success of this magnitude, it's not hard to see how much blood, sweat, and tears were poured into its creation process. And for anyone who is familiar with how brutal the development cycle of this game was, the term crunch will probably come to your mind. With many Bungie employees having stated they were expected to essentially work around the clock, and even spent days away from home in order for Halo 2 to reach its holiday deadline. And as a person who works a full-time job and sometimes struggles in writing a script after a long day at work, I find it pretty mind-blowing that they were able to power through and create such a timeless experience for millions of gamers all over the globe. Now, the story was often criticized for its cliffhanger-esque ending. It was actually a result of the crunch in development. And while this may have left a bad taste for those who relied on the campaign for their enjoyment, these shortcomings were mostly overlooked, as Halo 2 is now recognized as one of the greatest games of all time. In a year so chock full of AAA greatness, it's safe to say that Halo 2 is easily one of the most innovative games of the year 2004, and truly defined what standards were to be set in the realm of online gaming. Hate it or love it, I'm sure that most will agree they have spent some of their fondest childhood memories playing this game. And although the Halo franchise has seen better days, we can now take comfort in the fact that the second entry was a game powerful enough to connect the world in ways that had never been experienced before. It was a special moment for gaming, and an even more special time for the people who loved it. So for all my fellow Spartan soldiers, I salute you, and thank you for your service.
We now have direct confirmation of a disruptor in our midst. Unsophisticated minds giving him such dangerous poetic labels as the One Free Man, the Opener of the Way. If you see this so-called free man, report him. Civic deeds do not go unrewarded, and contrarywise, complicity with his cause will not go unpunished.
Imagine a world devoid of freedom. A world in which your every move is being watched. A world that doesn't wish to see you rise, but instead, it only aims to see you fall. A dystopian society thriving on power and oppression. But come to think of it, maybe this world isn't too far from our very own. But we'll save that conversation for another time. Because next on our list, we're here to discuss one of the most highly regarded video games to ever exist, to munch on a couple of head crab cakes and pop open a nice can of Dr. Breen's Private Preserve, because we're about to embark on a journey back to November 16th, 2004, this day being the release of Half-Life 2. Now, the original Half-Life was a huge deal back in the late 90s, and was even given over 50 PC Game of the Year awards. It was one of those games that really had a special way of immersing its players, and as someone who used to play their fair share of Half-Life back in the day, I can definitely attest to how great the game was, especially for its time. The fanbase of Half-Life was beginning to grow at a very rapid rate, and with talks of a sequel making the rounds in the gaming industry, many gamers across the globe were anxiously awaiting the next chapter in the series. Being both curated and published by Valve, development for Half-Life 2 began in June of 1999, just 6 months after the release of the first game. There was a team of over 80 developers working on the project, and were given no deadline for when the game should be finished. And with the creative space being given to the team, as well as a virtually unlimited budget, Valve's president Gabe Newell was setting his team up for success, and spoke that he aimed to do no less than redefine the genre of FPS gaming. They took note of how much their player base connected with the characters in the first game, and in turn created a much more realistic facial animation for their character model, thus giving their players a more immersive experience throughout the story. The team also integrated use of the Havoc engine, which accurately simulated real-life physics. This impressive engine allowed them to create a whole new mechanic of physics-based puzzles, which have grown to become a staple in many of Valve's most infamous titles. And in the case of Half-Life 2, it was responsible for creating one of the most unique FPS experiences the world had ever seen. Continuing the story of the first game's protagonist, Gordon Freeman, we find ourselves in a resistance to liberate Earth from the oppressive alien Combine Empire.
What a mouthful.
And when your attempt at being teleported to a main resistance base ends in you making your presence known to this evil organization, things are about to get very complicated for Mr. Freeman and his comrades. While many praise the game for its well-written narrative and range of colorful characters, one of the most impressive features of Half-Life 2 is its combat system. As we had mentioned before, the game made use of a highly advanced physics system for its time. This gave players a sense of freedom in how they chose to engage in each battle, and made for a unique experience for even the most well-versed of gamers. And despite multiple delays as well as the game's source code being leaked months before its release,
there was no breaking the stride of Valve's newest masterpiece.
Half-Life 2 was met with critical acclaim, boasting a 96 score on Metacritic, as well as being given 39 different Game of the Year awards. It was a commercial success, and was even regarded as the best game ever made by multiple critics. It's one of those titles that had so much hype and drama surrounding its release, that many of its fans were somewhat anxious to see how the final product would turn out. And despite all adversity, it's safe to say that Gabe Newell had achieved his goal in redefining the entire FPS genre. The true gamer's game. And if you've yet to experience it, now is the perfect time to do so. But just don't forget to bring your crowbar, because you're definitely going to be needing it. That's your mission.
Assassinating the boss.
The world was once one. We will heal that rift and make the world whole again. To do this, we need strength. An unstoppable trump card with enough power to bring order to the world. That trump card was to be the Shag-O-Hod and the Cobra unit.
In the infant stages of gaming, many developers aim to make their creations as entertaining as possible. Whether it was how a title was designed to be played, or the amount of challenge that it presented to its players, it was commonplace to find that gameplay was a primary focus in most games of the early to late 90s. Now, when it came to the separation of movies to video games, most people would agree that there was a stark contrast between the two. One meant to be interactive, while the other was only meant to be watched. But what happens when you combine both of these practices and create both an interactive and cinematic experience? Well, for Hideo Kojima, it meant creating one of the most legendary series in gaming history. You see, Kojima was a massive film buff and had dreams of working in the movie industry at a very young age. In his upbringing, Kojima and his family had a tradition of watching a new film each night. From horror to European cinema, there were no limits to the films that him and his family would watch together, which really begins to make sense when you see the wide range of influence in his games. While in college, he started searching for a way to get his foot in the door of the film industry, which eventually led to him beginning a career in game development. He applied to Konami and landed a job creating games for the MSX home computer. With success in this department, he was later asked to take over a project by the name of Metal Gear. And as most of you already know, this was the start of something very beautiful.
Kept you waiting, huh?
The original Metal Gear had become a commercial success on the NES, and even received multiple sequels. But when things really began to heat up for Kojima and his newfound IP, was with the 1998 release of Metal Gear Solid on the PlayStation 1. This was a game unlike anything ever seen before, combining cinematic storytelling, strategic gameplay, and an incredible sense of immersion for players of its time. Kojima was combining movies and video games in a way that had people totally entranced. With charming and unique characters, captivating dialogue, and plenty of action-packed missions to play through, it was no surprise that Metal Gear Solid was a series with an incredibly bright future. And on that note, that brings us to our next stop on the list, all the way back to November 17, 2004, this day being the release of what many argue to be Hideo Kojima's greatest creation. I'm talking about Metal Gear Solid 3 Snake Eater. Released on the PlayStation 2, Snake Eater was an incredible work in both storytelling and gameplay. Taking place 31 years before the events of Metal Gear Solid, we find ourselves playing through the story of a government operative by the codename Naked Snake. Snake is on a mission to rescue a Russian scientist who is being held somewhere in the Soviet jungle, and is also given the task of destroying an experimental nuclear weapon, otherwise known as the Shagohod. Upon arrival, we find that our former mentor has defected from the United States, and is also in cahoots with a team of supernatural soldiers called the Cobras. These soldiers are also interested in the Shagohod, but for much more nefarious reasons. And throughout the many twists and turns of this great story, you truly will find yourself captivated by the pure brilliance of the Metal Gear Solid universe. While the previous titles in this series were praised for their many innovations, Snake Eater took what improvements were already made and added even more depth to the player's experiences. Making use of a new camouflage system allowed the player to blend in with their environments, and was complemented by the addition of a new close quarters combat system. These changes gave a new freedom in how you go about each mission, and even rewarded those who were up to the challenge of using non-lethal tactics for boss battles. Snake Eater was also the first in the series to include online support, meaning fans of the series could finally put their combat skills to the test up against real-life players. But where Snake Eater truly shined was in its lengthy campaign, that was sure to keep you engrossed throughout its entire 16-hour playtime. It's one of those games that really sticks with you, and is personally one that's very near and dear to my heart. Combining action-packed gameplay, riveting characters, and an absolute banger of a theme song. Snake Eater is a game that truly shook the world of gaming. With an overall score of 91 on Metacritic, multiple awards, and being regarded as Kojima's greatest game, it's a title that just simply should not be slept on for anyone who has yet to experience it. So if you're one of the few poor souls yet to play this game, you're in luck, because it's very much readily available on modern PCs with the recent release of the Master Collection, and even has a full remake coming soon for all other modern platforms. It's really insane to think of all these incredible games that were released in the year 2004, but for me personally, this has to be my favorite on the list. When it comes to peak gaming experiences, you're sure to find it here. But just don't forget to brush up on your CQC, because it's for sure gonna come in handy.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, the time has finally come for us to arrive at the final stop on our list. So please, join us as we step into the magical world of Azeroth, a land of warring factions, vast landscapes, and sexy Night Elf Druids. We're about to find ourselves in a game in which I pretty much sank all of my teenage years into. I mean, I didn't go to homecoming, prom, or any of the fun parties that were happening in my neighborhood. No, I was much too busy trying to clear Black Queen Lair, or attempting to attain the entire judgment set for my paladin to be bothered with such foolishness. I guess it was safe to say that this game had a serious chokehold on me. And if you're still wondering what I'm even on about, I'm talking about World of Warcraft. Now, it's a sore subject for many RPG enthusiasts as the which MMO game really reigned supreme in the early 2000s. We had RuneScape, EverQuest, and Guild Wars just to name a few. But when it came to taking the world of MMOs by storm and creating a player base that is still going strong to this very day, World of Warcraft was the reigning champion. Released on November 23, 2004, World of Warcraft was a critical success and had garnered well over 1.5 million players within its first year of release. It was another one of those games that was highly innovative in terms of exploration and immersion. The game's world was incredibly large in scale, breaking stride from the typical formula of the former Warcraft titles. This new entry gave way to some serious open world exploration, much unlike anything ever seen before. This beautiful open world came with plenty of attention to detail, and each character race having their own unique starting zones. I remember the vast landscapes being one of the biggest reasons for this game having such a hold on me for so long. It all felt so immersive, and there were plenty of secrets and hidden areas to uncover as you adventured. While the main focus of the game was character progression, World of Warcraft also did a great job at giving its players an opportunity to make new friends, and even join guilds. The game rewarded players with shared XP being given to those who choose to party up for questing, as well as guild bonuses. It gave players an incentive to be social, and to interact with those around them. And when it came to leveling your character, they also gave you plenty of options in doing so. Whether you're grinding quests, running dungeons, or just killing boars in a field, everything including exploration would award its players with experience. They also made use of a rest system, a mechanic that essentially would give you an XP boost for a duration, depending on how long you were logged out of the game. This was a mechanic that was implemented for players to be able to catch up to those who had more time to level. I mean, we've all got that one friend, right? And while the Warcraft universe was already well established before the release of WoW, it was impressive the amount of lore that they packed into this game's story and ever-changing world. It really made you feel as though you were a part of something much bigger than your typical game. And with an addicting formula, stunning visuals, and insane replayability, it's no surprise that World of Warcraft is regarded as the quintessential MMORPG. It most definitely laid the foundation for every MMO that came after, and it's going to be one of those games that we talk about like Pong or Frogger in 50 years from now, sharing the many perilous tales of knights spent opposing the Horde, or leveling your human warlock till 9 in the morning. It was a special experience for many in the early 2000s, and this nostalgia was of course capitalized on with the recent re-release of WoW Classic. World of Warcraft still holds a steady player base of over 5.6 million active players, along with over 870,000 on the Classic version. And although it's been almost a decade since I last logged into my own personal account, I'll never forget the many fun-filled nights that were spent playing this game in my youth. And I hope you have plenty of fond memories to recount on as well. Even though it may not have been the most flashy or groundbreaking game to ever exist, World of Warcraft had aimed to become the next big thing for online gaming in 2004, and there's absolutely no denying it did just that. So whether you're all in for the Alliance or forever indebted to the opposing Horde, let's all take a moment to appreciate a legacy in gaming that will forever hold a special place in the hearts of many. In a year so full of magic and adventure, it's only right that we included this game on the list. But as all good things must come to an end, so must our journey. So thank you all for joining me in what may have been the greatest year for gaming. And whether you were too young to have experienced any of these games at release, or have yet to give a few of them a try, it's never too late to experience greatness. But for those who are entering their boomer stages in life such as I hope I was able to reinvigorate some of those nostalgic feels, and give you a little taste of the good old days once more. Hope you enjoyed the video, and please, leave a comment down below if there's any games from 2004 that I left out on the list. It was hard to narrow these down, so there were plenty of other options I could have included. But either way, I'd love to hear some of your favorites, and maybe even a little input on the ones we discussed. But I think it's time that I get back to present day. I hear we got a brand new Grand Theft Auto coming in 2025. I don't want to miss that. So stay safe, have a blessed new year, and I hope to see you in the next one. Peace.
10 cents.